Hi, this is the latest episode of Freedom is in Inkululeko. So today I thought I would talk about the NHI. So I don't know, I know many of you might be bothered with the NHI now, and the government's strongly pushing this idea, even though it's already been established that South Africa can't afford it. But it seems the government is pushing ahead. The policy has been developed, the law is I'm not sure if it has been passed or it's on the way to being passed, but anyway, and still there is no proper costing done of the thing and how it will cost us as the taxpayer and how it will work practically, because we know from the past, from Minister Tumbuweni's budget speech, that tax collections keep decreasing every year. So we are yet to see how government plans to implement it. But what I wanted to do was to examine some of the incentive structures in a system like the NHI has proposed in the policy paper. So I'll just read something that I've written on it now. So the NHI is said to be South Africa's version of universal healthcare, in which resources are pooled in order to provide health services for everyone. Apart from the many flaws in the way it is being implemented, one of the most serious of which is the fact that it is going to be prohibitively expensive. Less attention has been paid in the South African public discourse to the structure of the proposed system and the problems inherent within that system. The NHI now is a single-payer system in which the government would be the sole purchaser of health services on behalf of all South Africans. The government would also be responsible for certifying healthcare providers from both public and private providers. And so now you can see that already there will be some bias, because government will be certifying basically government provided services as well as private services. So who's to say that they won't be biased towards public services? I mean, and we also know from the current scandals emerging from the Zondo Commission around state capture, that government definitely engages in a lot of corruption. So it seems that the way is open there for even more corruption, because if public providers, which do things like tender out some of their things they need to be companies and all of those things, are also being certified by government, then this will and we are forced to pay into this one system, all of us, then wouldn't this tend to favor these inefficient public providers who are basically linked with government cronies? But we will see how it plays out. It is also envisioned that supply and demand side measures would be implemented in order to presumably contain the economic effects arising from having zero prices on the demand side of the equation. So this is one of the things that is mentioned in the NHI policy as released by government, that they plan to implement demand side measures so that they sort of control the amount of services that people demand. Now notice here that whereas in the current system, if you have a medical aid, you can demand as many services as you want, as you need rather, as long as you are willing to pay for it. Now government is going to be implementing demand side measures, so basically you'll be limited in the amount of services. Even if you need them, you'll be limited in the amount of services that you can get from the NHI. So we'll see how this works out. How likely are these measures to achieve their desired effects, considering the expected behavior of individuals on the demand side in the absence of market prices? And how does this expected behavior interact with the expected behavior of South African voters in their role as provider of healthcare services by determining taxation through the political process? Public choice theory, a microeconomic analysis of actors in their public as well as private market roles, allows us the tools to make these kinds of analyses. Even a relatively simple microeconomic model of behavior applied to voters and market participants allows us to arrive at conclusions that accord closely with reality. That is because we do not limit ourselves to examining only economic market participants, but also political market participants, who are often the same people. In South Africa, the bulk of taxes raised by government are in the form of personal income tax. And in the 2017-2018 tax year, 1.9 million South Africans contributed 80% of the revenue. Over the years, personal income tax has grown from being roughly making up the same proportion of revenue as VAT as VAT, the value-added tax, to being the single largest source of revenue. The reasons why are not difficult to see. VAT affects all voters. 80% of personal income tax is raised from less than 2 million South Africans out of almost 27 million registered voters. And only, I believe, about 6 million people are registered for personal income taxes, though not all of them pay. And so you have this situation where government is raising a huge proportion of its revenue from a very small pool of people who pay income taxes. This illustrates an important point with regards to South Africans as demanders of NHI services. At zero prices, the services offered by the NHI with the greatest elasticity of demand are going to experience the greatest demand from the public. In a country like the UK, one of the founders of public choice theory, James Buchanan, concluded that this increased demand for services in the NHS, which is their version of the NHI, did not result in increased supply of the service because voters in their role as suppliers of the service through taxation had an incentive to keep taxes on themselves as low as possible. This mismatch led to a deterioration in the quality of service offered by the UK's NHS. So everything you hear in the media about the NHS, about long waiting times, about limits of the number of services you can get out of the NHS and all of these things, basically it's because the UK voters are almost match exactly with the UK taxpayer. It's not perfect, but a greater proportion of people in the UK pay taxes, and so these people they pay taxes, but they also use NHS services, and so these they can sort of decide what appropriate level of service to offer, and then at the same time they can demand the services that they want to get from the NHS. And so when you vote, you are basically deciding on a level of taxation that should be levied by a government in order to fund the NHS. But on the other side, you are also a patient on the NHS. When you are sick, you have to go there, and so you because of the elasticity of demand of some services, let's say dentistry, for example, you will tend to want, because the prices are zero, you will tend to want more and more of those services. But at the same time, as a voter, you are voting for less and less taxation. And so what ends up happening is that you, even though you are demanding more and more services, but are supplying less and less of these services to the political processes because you don't want high taxes levied on you. Then what happens is that there is not enough services being offered. The demand doesn't match the supply. And so this leads to a deterioration of service. There will be long waiting times. There will be not enough staff hired to service everyone, etc., etc. The situation in South Africa is quite different from the UK because of the fact that so few people pay the taxes. This means that the marginal cost to the taxpayer of funding the NHI is likely to significantly outweigh the marginal utility derived from using the NHI. So what this means is that because the people who vote to supply the NHI services here in South Africa are not the same people who actually have to pay for these services, but they are the same people that have to that demand these services, that use these services. So voters and people who use the NHI services are roughly the same people, but the people who actually have to pay the tax for the services are not the same people as the people who vote. Like there's only about 2 million people are supplying 80% of the taxes, 80% of the personal income taxes. So what will happen is that the voters will vote for more and more services to be supplied in the NHI. And then on the other side, because their prices will be zero, people will be demanding more and more services. And so what will likely happen is that as happened with welfare in general in South Africa, welfare will end up, the NHI will end up taking more and more, a greater and greater portion of the government revenue, of the government budget. So it will tend to increase, and then this will be necessitating more and more taxes to be levied, and so the cost to you as a taxpayer will rise for using to supply these NHI services, but the utility that you are getting from them, like the benefit you are getting from these higher and higher taxes, will diminish over time because no matter how many which services that you yourself want to use or use or get from the NHI, the voters will keep voting more and for more and more services, and there are many more voters and users of the NHI services than they are taxpayers, much more. So what will happen is that those people paying taxes then have one of two options. Either they can leave the country or stay but figure out a way of reducing their tax burdens. In other words, the voters will have an incentive to impose more and more taxes on the small population paying taxes in order to fund greater and greater levels of service, especially with regards to the NHI services that have the greatest elasticity of demand. The taxpayers will get to the point where the benefits of the NHI is outweighed by the cost because of this. They will act rationally in trying to reduce this burden. And so this will massively affect the South African economy, as you can imagine, where the taxpayers are leaving the country or trying to avoid paying taxes through some other means. And this will be a massive hit to the economy because they have less incentives to start businesses, for example, because of just the high tax burden. The demand measures, for example, gatekeeping proposed by the minister in the NHI policy, are not what the paper they are written on. As long as the tax system is structured as it is now, some political competitors to the government of the day will come along and propose reducing or eliminating any demand limitation measures. The point here is that there can be no social solidarity, which is one of the rationales given for the NHI, without shared pain in the form of the tax burden. South Africa cannot have a system similar to the British NHS given the socio-economic state of the country, where a tiny minority pay most of the taxes. Given that you are a democracy, such a situation leaves us vulnerable to the possibility of taxing the golden goose to death, because any welfare measure is under the control of people who do not have to pay for it. With everyone acting rationally in the private as well as public arenas, the introduction of a system like the NHL will likely destroy the South African economy. And yeah, so those are my thoughts on the NHI from a public choice perspective. Just comment and tell me what you think. But I'm sorry that I have to end on a gloomy note, but it is what it is. It's a very stupid idea to have a system like the NHI. A much better system would be a voucherization of the health services, but it would still suffer from incentive problems as well. And so I don't think that a country like such as ours, which is still an emerging economy, can afford these kinds of welfare measures. More important is growing the economy so that more and more people are engaged in productive activities and become taxpayers, and then you can think about welfare, because the incentives will be much better aligned and won't cause such damage to the economy. And thank you for listening, and goodbye.